The following is a special presentation of ABC Sports.
I can honestly sit here and say that I've seen every single game of Monday Night Football.
In 3, 2, 1, take.
Every Monday Night Football game, it's like a little Super Bowl because everybody's watching.
It is indeed the night when the players become fans.
Deflected, but it's still caught here by number 33, Tony Dorsett.
Look out.
All right. Norm Thompson misses. It should be all over. It's all over.
He gets a good kick away, and Taylor fields the ball at the 5-yard line, which is unusual to begin with. Not recommended. However, he breaks from the pack.
They're giving the football to Perry. Touchdown. William Perry. Bikes the football.
We have our expert with us here this evening. Don, have you conferred with him about what we might expect the second half?
What do you think? He said there's a veritable plethora of talent out there.
Look out. Walter, Little Brothers on his way. Eddie Payton, 98 yards.
When you played on Monday night, you knew the country was watching, and you had the premier broadcast team. And you got up a little bit more for them.
That's on. In and out of the
head. There it is. Four.
They got to accept that. I
don't believe it.
Who is it? Dick Anderson. How about that?
Indianapolis is the 41-yard line. And Dickerson's huge lane continues his fourth touchdown.
I didn't know you cared.
Yeah.
You know, anytime you're the only show in town and everybody's interested, it's very special. And when you're playing Monday Night Football, it's the only show going on in the whole league.
This is Joe Washington.
That is Joe Washington.
Look at this.
That is Joe Washington.
He's on his feet. He has great speed.
That is Joe Washington.
Oh, this. How can it happen?
ABC's big party, the 25th year. We gotta get ready, we gotta get right. Cause Monday Night Football's coming on tonight. So get ready, I mean get ready. Are you ready for some football? For Monday Night Party? Yeah, this is old Hank and I'm back and I'm ready to get this thing started. So put the teams on the field and get them pumped up right, cause all my rowdy friends are back for Monday night. Rock them, boys! Well, for 25 years we've been watching these games. The great teams and all the big names, from the Steel Curtain to two kids called Joe. Even Johnny U played on this show. We've seen the perfect pass and the race and back, the TD dive and the nasty sack. The best of all played on ABC. What we got here is a dynasty. Oh, you're ready for some football? A Monday Night Party? This is rock and roll. Get this thing started. Get those helmets crashing. The crowd is psyched, cause all my rowdy friends are back for Monday night. Yes, everybody is a fan. This is the biggest party, man. We got Frank and Al and Dan. They're gonna get it kick started. Week after week, it's the time that is right. All my rowdy friends are
Hi, and welcome to the home video celebrating the 25th anniversary of Monday Night Football. I'm Al Michaels with Frank Gifford and Dan Dierdorf, and you know, it all began 25 years ago with a game between the New York Jets and the Cleveland Browns. And Monday Night Football changed the way Americans watched television. And Monday Night Football became an event that was a hot topic of conversation around the office cooler every Tuesday morning. And Frank, you've been a part of it longer than almost anyone.
24 years out of the 25 years. And Al, you think back, and it was really a bold experiment by ABC to begin with, and it's turned into an American tradition. And I'm proud to have been associated with it for those 24 years out of 25. And you know, guys, that's exactly twice as long as I played pro football with the Giants. Hard to believe.
Well, guys, you know, this is going to be my 8th year as a broadcaster for Monday Night Football. Boy, that's hard to believe as well. You know, but this show has been on the air longer than any primetime show in the history of the ABC television network. In fact, Monday Night Football is the 3rd longest running primetime show on any network.
Well, as I said, it all started with the Jets and the Browns. The Jets had won Super Bowl III in 1969, upsetting the Colts, as was predicted by Joe Namath before the game. But Namath and the Jets found it a little more difficult to succeed in the primetime spotlight of Monday Night Football.
It was no surprise that Joe Namath was in the spotlight of the very first Monday Night Football game ever. Calling the action were ABC announcers Keith Jackson, Howard Cosell, and the former Dallas Cowboy quarterback Dandy Don Meredith. The very first play on Monday night was a very short gain for Namath and the Jets.
He's up to 36.
Namath's first pass from scrimmage also went awry.
Swings it to Snell and he dropped it. It was a forward pass.
He may have been called Broadway Joe, but his Jets were never ready for prime time.
I don't have good memories of playing on Monday night because my teams didn't fare well.
But the Jets are behind on the scoreboard by a score of 14-7. And the ball game for the second half is underway as Jim Turner kicks off. It goes to Homer Jones. Homer takes it at the 6-yard line for the Cleveland Browns, and he breaks into the open. Now it's a foot race. He'll go all the way. And there are no penalty flags on the field. Homer Jones goes 94 yards to start the second half.
Joe Willie put some impressive numbers on the board and brought the Jets back into the game.
Joe to throw. He's going deep into the corner for Sully. He's got it. 34 yards. Joe Namath to George Sauer for the touchdown.
But Namath only threw one touchdown and was intercepted 3 times by the Browns.
To play, the Browns lead 24-21. Before more than 85,000 people, Snyder almost gets Namath. The pass is intercepted. It is intercepted by number 52, Billy Andrews. Touchdown and no penalty flag on the field. There's a depressed Joe Namath.
The games that stick out were the tough losses. I made a very poor throw, and it was intercepted by a linebacker, and we lose the game. It was late in the game, and if we take it down and score, we'll probably win.
7 times we saw Broadway Joe on Monday Night Football. He threw only 5 touchdown passes, but when he did, he left us with some wonderful memories.
Caster, and Rich Caster has it. He may go all the way.
7 times on Monday Night Football and 7 defeats. Not a great record, but certainly a great player.
Well, Broadway Joe was not all that successful on Monday nights, but he was clearly one of the most colorful quarterbacks we've ever watched through the years on Monday Night Football.
So many quarterbacks did have great success on Monday night. Think about the Dallas Cowboys' Roger Staubach, or scrambling Fran Tarkenton of the Minnesota Vikings, or how about the spirited New York Giant, Phil Sims?
Dan, there's also a pair of Dans who work 3,000 miles apart on Monday Night Football. San Diego Chargers' Dan Fouts and the Miami Dolphins' Dan Marino.
Or how about a pair of Joes who also worked on opposite ends of the country, the Washington Redskins' Joe Theismann, and maybe the most successful of all the quarterbacks ever, Joe Montana.
And Montana going deep. He's got Rice, and Rice makes the catch.
Rice in motion, second and goal. Montana on a roll to his right. Has room. And Montana, touchdown, he's in there.
First and 10.
Taylor on a
slanting, breaks two tackles inside the 20, inside the 10. Taylor in for the touchdown.
They're playing all over the field. Now the safety blitz, a delay is on. Montana reads it, gets it to Nehemiah, it's all over.
Nehemiah was a bullfrog.
Terry Kennard.
Second and 8 from the 32-yard line. Montana, that short drop, and then a little slant to Rice. Rice inside the 15, the 10. Touchdown, Jerry Rice.
Oh, he's magic. Not bad either. He is bad.
All of the nights you came to me, now it's so strange you're in KC. You wondered how you'd make it through. I knew how hard it was for you, but now we're standing face to face. Isn't this world still the greatest, Joe? Yeah,
yeah. Everybody's busy thinking about what their job is on Sunday afternoon. There's a plethora of games, and all of a sudden, you know, Monday night, the spotlight turns to one specific game, and it's a very, very big deal to do well on Monday Night Football.
Playing against Pittsburgh in 1973, it probably was the best individual game that I ever had, and it was on Monday Night Football. Four interceptions and two touchdowns in the first half.
On third down and 8, Gilliam back, good protection. Oh, and it's picked off. Dick Anderson. Dick Anderson, touchdown, and did he read that beautifully?
Yeah.
Oh, Gilliam, third down and 10. Unloads it, picked off, Dick Anderson.
Well, that could spell the difference. They may have to bring Bradshaw in now, but I think he's going all the way.
Uh-oh. Anderson, who returned one earlier for a touchdown, returns this one 32 yards to the 2.5-yard line. It's 33. Bradshaw firing, forget it. Dick Anderson, his third interception. Touchdown, 38 yards.
Oh, my. I don't think I've ever seen anything like it.
I can't believe it.
Three interceptions by Anderson in a little over one quarter.
Two for touchdown. Bradshaw in and out of the
hands. There it is, four and one ball game.
I can't believe it. Who is it? Dick Anderson. How about that?
Four interceptions. He's the leading receiver tonight.
That's right.
With only a few seconds remaining and Dallas trailing Washington 14-7, Kenny Houston would stop Walt Garrison with the game-saving tackle on the one-yard line to preserve the victory for the Redskins.
A lot of people say that jarring tackle got Ken Houston into the Hall of Fame, where he hit Walt Garrison. The Redskins went on to win the game. That, in my mind, I'm sitting in the end zone, and he makes an unbelievable play in a great, great game.
O.J. Simpson gets the call. Well, look out.
That's what they got to do.
Just about right this off. Oh, and down goes Simpson at the 23. He gets up again.
What a football player.
And
White.
The Cincinnati fans are all on their feet. They're seeing O.J. Simpson at his very best. Just short of their own 9-yard line. The two tight ends are in there, indicative of a running attack. Here comes O.J. again. Look at the juice. O.J. spinning, twisting. He's all the way down to the 47-yard line. This man, number one in just about everything.
Oh, he's too
Look
much.
Look at this. He splits inside.
He is too much.
Inside the 30, and boy, does he turn on a crowd. First down, Ken Riley made the save.
Joe Washington up in, I think it was Foxborough at the time, in the rain, having that great night, returning the kick, and I don't know what, he scored all these touchdowns in the rain, and it was, I just remember, I thought that was the most awesome performance I've ever seen on Monday night.
Toss goes to Washington, and he can pass. He has a man wide open. He's got Roger Carr.
Roger Carr.
How do you like that?
I liked it. Joe Washington, 54-yard Baltimore touchdown. He's got Joe Washington all
wide
alone.
Open. It's
yes,
Washington.
Sir. Oh, that was pretty. Wilson. This is Joe Washington. That is Joe Washington.
Look at this.
That is Joe Washington.
He's on his feet. He has great speed.
That is Joe Washington.
Oh, this. How could it happen?
Oh, God.
What a football game this turned out to be.
How about Joe Washington?
Do you believe Joe Washington's night?
He wore number 12 for the Raiders and was known as the Snake.
Complete. Cliff Branch, and what a move. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Catch him. Goodbye. There are no flags down. Is that wild?
That happened fast.
The first down is at the 17-yard line. Ramsey's intended. He's
all alone. How do you like
all
this?
All alone. We got ourselves a good one.
What a ball game this is turning out to be.
Stabler. Cliff Branch touchdown. Cliff Branch was spectacular. He was, well, I won't say Vince, but he did not start.
We really played well on Monday night, and to try to put your finger on why is hard. I don't know. I've always thought that because you had to lay around all afternoon and be bored and watch everybody else play and want to get out there, that once you got out there, you really cranked it up.
It's difficult to forget the spectacular performances on Monday Night Football, but it's also difficult to forget some unbelievable Monday Night miscues as well, both on the field and in the booth. And we've had our share of fun.
Hello again, everyone. I'm Howard Cosell. Welcome to still another Monday night of NFL football right here on ABC. We look for a super game tonight. And as you can readily see, I have undergone cosmetic surgery. The face has changed, but the body is superbly unchanged.
So does Sistrum from the University of Mars. He's the scariest guy I've ever seen in my life.
Blitz on again. Completion is Bobby Duckworth. They shouldn't catch him. He has great speed.
Football.
Do you believe that?
I remember looking very closely after the fumble and seeing gloves on Duckworth's hands. Well, here we are in San Diego, perfect ideal conditions, and this fellow's wearing gloves. And I don't think he ever wore gloves again after that.
A little too much wiggle in his wobble, and the ball just wiggled out.
Wiggling a wobble. Funny but sad.
Turn out the lights. The party's over. They say that all good things must end.
Second and nine. Kelly. And
whoa, that's got to come out.
Is there a flag? Yes, there is. Johnson getting the piggyback ride. James Lofton.
And now if he would have just flipped him over, put him down for the three count, he had a nice pin.
Right there is a vivid picturization of the excitement at Tundin.
And number one in the nation.
Many teams had great players who wore number 32. The Raiders had a great back who could do it all. Marcus Allen.
Marcus to the 10, to the 5, touchdown, Marcus Allen.
What a great effort.
Out of Brooklyn.
First down and at the 30-yard line now for the Raiders. Everyone's in the pattern. And Plunkett has time. Looking for Allen.
Right.
Spectacular catch.
Oh.
Marcus Allen.
Right two.
Allen into the end zone.
Yeah, that did it.
Crowd all on their feet. Third and 10 now for Plunkett. Got a man open, it's Marcus Allen. Allen with a great cutback. There are no flags.
Dallas on Monday night, and it was a very exciting game for a lot of reasons. One, for myself, because I had passed for 5,000 yards, and we won in the last minute and a half, and Mark Clayton broke the NFL touchdown record, too, also in that game. He had to have three touchdown receptions to break the record, and I remember him telling me before the game, he said, just give me a chance to get it, you know, and I said, you'll have your chance, you know, and at the end, we didn't think he was going to get it, and at the end, we get the ball back with like a minute left, and the second play, I hit him on a pass, and he goes 70 yards for a touchdown with it, to break the record, plus to win the game with only like 40 seconds left. I mean, it was really a thrilling night, I think, you know, for the Dolphins, plus because the last game, we knew we had a great team, chance to get to the Super Bowl, and on Monday night, 5,000 yards for myself, Mark Clayton breaking the touchdown record. It was exciting.
With an injured shoulder, the Giants and Redskins didn't know if LT would play. The Redskins would wish he hadn't.
And Trader sacked. Guess who?
Well, he's having a night, isn't he?
Taylor sacked.
They knew he was coming. They couldn't do anything about it. He's so quick. He's so strong.
Montana throws in wide open to the 20-yard line as Taylor, with the defensive back falling down. Newman can't make the tackle. Taylor is inside the 30, inside the 20, inside the 10. Touchdown, San Francisco. 92 yards. From Santa for the 49ers to stay in the game as Taylor makes the catch. Eludes Irvin, eludes Newman. Chased by Kelm. Down the sidelines he goes. He ran 92 for a touchdown before. He's in again.
Oh, this is a very weird game.
96
yards. Oh, and I'm glad I'm
here.
Only two letters in his first name, and they should have been TD.
There he goes. One man to beat. He beats him. No chance.
What a game.
You don't want to see a great performance. You watched Bo Jackson again in that Seattle game.
And Bo Jackson to the 20 and out in front, and only one man to beat, and Easley can't run him down. He had the angle, but there goes Bo, and nobody catches Bo. Touchdown.
He may not stop till Tacoma. He's gone.
Portland.
He just went by Spokane.
And there go the Raiders into find. What a scene.
Look how many people have the angle on Bo Jackson. I mean, everybody had it. They had about four people had the angle on him. And Bo just like put it in another gear and just scooted on down the sideline. I mean, it was like, it was no great moves there. There was no power far as, you know, knocking people off you. And it was just all out 100% speed. And, you know, what they say, you know, speed kills. And he killed a lot of people that night.
He was Tony Dorsett by birth, TD by profession. A profession of scoring touchdowns.
Everybody in the stadium, everybody on TV. I mean, Howard Cosell was even talking about it. Everybody knew who was going to run the ball.
Big opening for Tony Dorsett. Look out, he's got great speed.
99 yards and a half.
Dorsett down the sideline. Stays in bounds.
Can you believe that?
Short, because they're 99
yards.
Short yardage defense, all bunched up. And that's the 99 and a half yard run, I think, is the longest run in the history of the league.
It is.
Actually, I didn't know it was a record-setting run. I really wasn't paying attention to it. I was so caught up and involved in the game.
And when I got to the sideline, Gil Brandt said, I think that's an NFL record. And then it dawned upon me, like, hey, I should have kept the ball. And that was the thing. The first thing that came to my mind was, I should have kept the ball. Of course, I never got that football, though.
The Cowboys entered the 90s with yet another stellar running back, a 5'9 phenom who would lead them to two straight Super Bowls. His name, Emmitt Smith.
Smith, first down, and a lot more. Into Redskin territory. Emmitt Smith being chased down. They will not get him. Touchdown. Well, they answered, Dan. At the 29 now. Emmitt Smith swings to the outside. Picks up three. Still going! Emmitt Smith doing a Barry Sanders imitation. Touchdown. Current Bronco coach setting it 26 seasons ago. Emmitt again. Oh, he's fun to watch. To everybody but Atlanta. Touchdown.
There's number 18. You're seeing some great running and you're seeing some horrific tackling.
A funny name, threw a downfield block, watching Emmitt's flames, looking up through the roof at the Texas stars, a dream in my eye and a prayer in my heart. I should have been a cowboy. I should have learned to play with pride, wearing my silver star, marching down a field on a TD drive. I should have been a cowboy.
Perhaps the greatest receiver in the history of the NFL, San Francisco's Jerry Rice, has had some of his finest moments on Monday night. Buffalo's Jim Kelly threw for 5 touchdowns, 392 yards in one game on Monday night.
Goes deep, and the catch is made by Lofton, and a flag is down. Two flags at the 40. Touchdown, Buffalo, for the moment.
Third and one for one of the rare times.
Oh, wide open. Huddled, and wide open is Pete Metzelaars inside the 20, and Metzelaars is in for the touchdown. He did not step out of bounds.
Why he's number one quarterback in the league. First and 10 at the 48-yard line. And Kelly going deep. And the catch is made by Lofton.
Eric Dickerson transcended two decades and three teams. In the 80s and 90s, he led the Colts.
Breaks the tackle, touchdown.
Great ones do that.
They give it to Dickerson. And Dickerson has his second touchdown. Indianapolis is the 41-yard line. And Dickerson's huge night continues his fourth touchdown.
And in 1992, wearing a different uniform, he still dazzled us with some of his old magic.
Send the tailback in the eye. Eric gets the ball. Eric has his first 10-yard run of the season.
Goodbye.
20, 30, 40 yards for the touchdown.
It just exploded through there.
Over 400 games, you know, it's difficult to try to pick the greatest game. We've asked many people, and although not everyone agreed, the consensus was a game that you thought was best too, Frank.
Well, they all seem to run together after the years, but I think you're probably right, Al. That Monday night game back in 1978, the Astrodome in Houston, it was alive with blue. The Miami Dolphins with Bob Greasy having a great night, but they ran into a one-man oiler wrecking crew.
The crowd behind me roaring. Pom-poms everywhere in display as the Houston Oilers are about to be introduced. Hello again, everyone. We think tonight we've got about as good a matchup as you could have.
And what a matchup it was. Don Shula coaching the Miami Dolphins, Bum Phillips, the Oilers.
Of course, that was the first time that
that I can remember that that pro football had pom-poms. And that night, it was absolutely fabulous. Everybody in that stadium had a pom-pom, and everybody in that stadium was waving that doggone thing. And it was like a college ball game. It was just exactly like a college football game. The crowd was into it more than any game I've ever seen.
The Dolphins struck quickly and led 7-0. But the Oilers responded the first time they got the ball.
The Campbell finds a man open. He goes to his tight end, Barber, and Barber has a first down Miami territory at the 41.
Now, near the goal line, everyone knew who would get the ball.
Campbell, forget it. 6 points.
Oh, boy, this is a football game.
Houston would then take the lead in the second quarter.
Third down, 7. Barber. Touchdown, Houston. And Pastorini started to run. He looked up. 86 was there. Dumped it off. 6 points. The Oilers.
Bob Greasy would lead Miami back to tie the game just before the half.
Jimmy Cephalo, flank wide to the right. Looking for Dorial Harris. Harris jarred but holds on down at the 32-yard line. First down Miami. That was a great catch.
Inches away. 34 seconds left. Counting down. Greece has got 2 timeouts left.
Touchdown, Miami. They were within 1 of tying it up.
What a football game this is. Repeat everything we expected.
In the third quarter, Dan Pastorini would use his rookie running back to take the lead again.
Pastorini brings the Oilers up. Looks over a 2nd down and 8. Bob Matheson was checked in defensively for Miami. He wears number 53, the veteran defensive linebacker. Earl Campbell breaks one tackle, and this is what he does so well. Breaks a tackle right at the line of scrimmage, gets a first down, 49-yard line of the Oilers.
With the Oilers near the goal line, Bum Phillips watched as Campbell put the Oilers back on top.
2nd down, forget it. That's what he can do now.
Oh, boy.
Touchdown, Houston, Earl Campbell.
Yeah, it was awesome, and I was one of the things I always remember, that game, 199 yards by Earl Campbell.
They called Campbell the baby bull, but Miami refused to fold.
Miami has been a cold team in the second half, and I just saw a kind of shrug from Shula. Let's see if Miami can pull itself together.
1st and 20, Norm Boulash is in. Bell Williams is in. Boulash, of course, a better receiver than Leroy Harris. Greasy in trouble, but he finds Matt Moore. Watch out. Mike Reinfeldt makes the saving tackle at the 12-yard line, and Bob Greasy showed you his all-pro credentials, coolly standing there as Oilers circle all around him.
We have 2:29 left in the third quarter.
Miami is a 1st and goal. Down, and Miami is within 1 point of tying this game up again.
In the fourth quarter, tied at 21, Bob Greasy and the Dolphins were stopped cold by the Houston defense until the Oilers and Dan Pastorini were pinned down by a coffin corner Miami punt.
Roberts looking for the corner. Oh, and is he hit a beauty?
What a kick!
Right at the 3-yard line. George Roberts with a tremendous kick. 46 yards, and he puts it out at the 3.
This game had it all. In the fourth quarter, A.J. Dewey sacked Pastorini for a safety.
Wrench, Houston in deep trouble. Their own 3-yard line. Great kick by George Roberts. 12:25 remaining in the football game. It's tied at 21. That is regulation play.
Pastorini from the end zone, safety.
With the Oilers trailing by two, they once again gave the ball to the rookie running back.
Dan Pastorini steps into the Houston Oilers huddle. He has 11 minutes and 4 seconds with which to work. He has a first and 10, the ball at his own 20-yard line. He is down by 2 points. The quick toss goes to Earl Campbell. And Earl Campbell just does his thing, moving out close to the 29-yard line.
I don't believe Earl Campbell was ever a rookie. From the time he came into the league, he was all pro. I really believe he's the best running back to ever pull on the pad, and especially in the fourth quarter. The guy, from his 20th carry to his 40th, he was great. He had more stamina than anybody in the world.
First down, 44-yard line of the Dolphins. Clock ticking away. Inside 9 minutes. Earl Campbell, right side. Thrust forward, he pulls it back, he has another Houston first down. John Schumacher, a rookie from USC, he lines up, has to report to the officials because he wears number 62. He lines up at tight end. Campbell to the outside.
Goodbye!
Oh, is he putting on a show tonight?
So they stand as one. The side showed quickly. Look out, America. Here comes Houston, America's fastest growing city. And right now, in this arena, America's football team.
With the clock ticking down in the fourth quarter, Greasy led the Dolphins on yet another march downfield in an attempt to regain the lead.
Has the time, has the receiver, Duriel Harris. Harris tries to get free from Willie Alexander, but he goes down in Oiler territory at the 42, and Greasy brings him roaring back again. Ticking away, 3 minutes, 20 seconds remaining in the game. 28-23, the Oilers over the Dolphins. Going for Tillman. That is deflected into the arms of Steve Kiner.
The flag goes down. Flag down, but that should do it.
For the second time in 7 minutes, Campbell would find the end zone. He became only the ninth rookie to rush for over 1,000 yards, finishing this day with 199 yards.
Look out!
He's gone!
He's gone all the way! Puts his head down. 80-yard touchdown. This is over. What a show this man has put on tonight.
And he went 80 yards, outran the secondary, outran a corner. Safety, they couldn't catch Earl Campbell in the fourth quarter late after he'd already carried the ball 30-some times. And I already knew Earl Campbell was special. That was something else.
Miami scored once more as time ran out, but Houston prevailed. And Bum Phillips would give the speech when Earl Campbell was inducted into the Football Hall of Fame.
To me, deep down, I think that's the greatest game on Monday Night Football to this point I've ever seen.
Earl Campbell certainly took his game to a higher level that night in Houston. We've seen a number of players lift their games to another level on Monday Night Football, setting some Monday Night records in the process.
Kozar, Webster, Slaughter, Jackson chasing Slaughter, spins, stays on his feet. 98 yards on first down. Bernie Kosar puts it up. What a call.
Put a fork in the Bears. They're done.
Second and goal. And Marino throws and it's picked off by Anderson. And Eddie Anderson is out past the 20. The 30 cuts it back. He's going to pick up some blocking. They take care of Higgs, who was the last man to have a chance at him.
Unbelievable.
And he goes all the way.
Unbelievable. We're going to have a 10-point ball game.
McIver came flying in, but he gets
a good kick away, and Taylor fields the ball at the 5-yard line, which is unusual to begin with. Not recommended, however, he breaks from the pack.
Goodbye.
And he has blocking. And Taylor, all alone, is going to go all the way. 95 yards, touchdown. No flags.
And in a special Thursday edition of Monday Night Football, the kickoff return record was broken.
Wood hits it.
He had a good one.
Iru Matthews out of the end zone.
Uh-oh.
Look out. Iru Matthews. Turn out the right deep in his end zone. Iru Matthews. It looked to be 103 yards.
Ladies and gentlemen, we had a football game.
Oh, I can't believe it.
Goodbye.
And Griffin has an escort.
Convoy, he's got them all.
Inside the 30, Don Griffin's going to go all the way.
Light up another cigar, Wayne. Look at the entire 49er team empties the bench and they come out to grab Griffin.
It's all boiled down to this. 20 seconds remaining to be played in the game. The Chargers lead 17-10. It's second down. The ball is on the 2-yard line. The big man gets the call. Edwards, Ted Edwards.
The Cardinals said Edwards had tied it up at 17 with 17 seconds left. But St. Louis's unsuccessful attempt at an onside kick gave the Chargers new hope and set up a Dennis Partee field goal attempt.
San Diego, possibly two plays, maybe even three. It looks good. It is good.
How about that?
Look at that halo.
They're mobbing Partee.
Unbelievable. Partee is in there.
That, the game is over.
Just as the can goes on.
It was September of 1974, and Dallas with Coach Tom Landry was already known as America's team.
This is Dennison, and Dennison pounds and fumbles. Oh, goodbye.
Oh, look at this. A foot race was fouled back. He's going to go all the way on it. Can you believe that?
Lavender's return became one of Monday Night Football's all-time highlights. But in the fourth quarter, the game was tied at 10. Tom Dempsey attempted a 45-yard field goal with 25 seconds remaining.
Make it 46.
Close your eyes if you're for Dallas. That looks good.
It is good. Dempsey does it again. Tom Dempsey does it again.
We're mobbing it.
At Mile High Stadium, the Raiders came back from a 24-point deficit, matching the greatest comeback ever on Monday night.
Pass to Smith. Inside the 30. There goes Smith again. Down the sideline. Touchdown. Again, Steve Smith.
With the Raiders trailing by three with 4 seconds left, it was up to the foot of Chris Barr to send the game into overtime.
Good. Chris Barr comes through to tie the game. A 44-yard field goal, 4 seconds on the clock.
In overtime, John Elway was intercepted for a fourth time.
Finally, he throws an interception at the 50-yard line into the hands of Zeffley, who had just come into the game, and he takes it to the 31.
That gave Chris Barr a chance to win it, and win it he did with a kick from 35 yards out, giving the Raiders a stirring 30-27 comeback victory. Mardi Gras began 4 months early in New Orleans. With the score tied at 17, Morton Anderson lined up a 49-yard field goal attempt for the Saints.
If he makes this place is going to come apart.
49-yard will be the official
yardage. Brian Hansen, punter, is the holder. On its way. It's good! No time remaining. The Saints have won on a 49-yard field goal by Morton Anderson.
In Miami, the Dolphins were tied with the Browns in the final minute of play. Dan Marino at quarterback for the Dolphins.
Marino going for it all for Banks. Touchdown.
No.
One official signals touchdown and the other said he went out. He's inside the one, but the official, the field judge signaled touchdown.
34 seconds left and the Dolphins on the doorstep.
To the tailback Hampton.
For Mike Ditka, it was just another day at the office. 5 seconds remained in the fourth quarter, and the Bears had one shot at a touchdown to tie the Jets.
Harbaugh, throw! Touchdown to Anderson!
I don't believe this. There's no time on the clock.
His second reception of the night.
And in typical Monday night fashion, the Bears would win it in overtime. Or would they?
Harbaugh on a roll. Harbaugh throwing to Bosa, and they end the game with a touchdown.
Bears football. Let's take a look. Where does his knee's down?
The drama finally came to a conclusion.
And Harbaugh dives in, and we're waiting for a signal. There is none yet. Now there is, and we think the game is over.
Shakespeare would have been proud of this dramatic finish. Kansas City trailed the Raiders by 4 points late in the fourth quarter. Steve DeBerg led the Chiefs on their final march.
DeBerg fires over the middle, nearly picked off by Ladd. Instead, it winds up in Holahan's hands. First down.
Plenty of time. They're not in any time problem.
4 shots at the end zone. DeBerg throws wide open is Barnett.
DeBerg paid the price. He held on until Barnett uncovered.
At the Kingdom, with the score tied at 13, a late Broncos face mask penalty gave the Seahawks great field position and one final chance.
Stopper, the deep drop, fires into the end zone. Touchdown to Flames.
I've seen some things in my life, but few have matched it.
Casey's extra point had tied the game with no time remaining and now faced a 32-yard attempt late in overtime.
Broncos were offside. That should do it. The Broncos were offside.
Al Davis and the Raiders were arguably one of the best teams on Monday Night Football. They won with the good, the bad, and the ugly.
53 yards for Jager. Gossett puts it down. The kick is low. And long enough.
That's the ugliest game-winning field goal from that distance ever, but the Raiders don't care.
He
how did it not get blocked?
I have never seen a kick that long, kick that low.
It almost looked like it was spiraling.
Well, Dan said it better. That was really ugly.
It was really ugly, and nobody in Los Angeles for the Raiders cares. Unbelievable.
Well, it's been a great 25 years, Dan. You ready for 25 more?
I think this is the greatest job in sports. You're darn right. I could do another 25. How about you, Frank?
Oh, wait a minute. 24, 25, 49 years. Hey, guys, good luck. I'll be watching you, okay?
Well, for all those who came before us.
And all of those who appeared in front of us.
And to all of you who continue to watch us, thanks. And so long.
See this man on a TV. dripping in sweat from head to toe. They make you believe it's the status quo. You're playing on Monday, it's touch and go. All systems go, friend or foe. Miami depends on the pass you throw. Come without a warning like San Diego. You're playing on Monday, it's touch and go. See this man on a TV show. He's dripping in sweat from head to toe. They make you believe it's the status quo. You're playing on Monday, it's touch and go.